So the Komal Ga. Ga. See, the komal dha is exactly a major third down from the sa. Da. And then a komal ga is exactly a fifth up from there. See, so it makes this minor beautiful. Even dissonant notes like re. There's a certain resonance where that becomes sweet. Huh? And that is called a swara. So in Vedic music, every note should be swara. Every note should be harmonic. Like that. So when we do kirtan, we like to make every note swara. Uddhava? 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 Can you go up the road a little bit? Yeah, we're hearing everything. So, kind of a weird day today, huh? What was that? Oh yeah, it's time to pay the electric bill again. So anyway, swara is the source of rasa. And in our personal relationships, when we have harmony, then we experience rasa, sweet taste. That's what rasa means. Nice sweet taste. And in music, when the harmony is exact, it has to be exact, it has to be precise. And what happens is the two notes, the vibrations of the two notes form a stable pattern in the air. When we feel that, then it's like, it's like beauty, harmony. It's the essence, it's the actual definition of beauty. This swara relationship, harmonic relationship. And when there's some disharmony, it simply means that we're out of the swara. We're not feeling rasa. Then there's disharmony. So in life, there are so many disharmonies. But if we have the beauty of music, the beauty of devotion to God, the beauty of nice relationships with the other devotees and the spiritual master, then we somehow can tolerate the discords, because we know we can get through it and we can get some real taste out of life. And the ultimate thing is when we have this rasa, this harmonic relationship with God. God is within everyone's heart. And we can approach Him directly, personally. And we can have a relationship with Him based on one of these rasas. We don't usually mess around with neutrality. We go for servitorship, friendship, parenthood, and conjugal love. Those are the four main relationships of bhakti. And bhakti means that we approach God and we render service to Him in one of these four moods. Rasas, bhavas. So this is prema, this is divine love. This is pure and eternal. And satisfying to the heart because it's purely harmonic. Now the other thing I wanted to talk about today, I had planned to talk about today. Let's take this. We recently published the Vedanta Sutra, complete Vedanta Sutra. And this has been something I wanted to do for a long time. Because Srila Prabhupada wanted Vedanta Sutra to be studied in all of his temples. He wanted all his disciples to study the scriptures and to take examinations on those scriptures. And the scriptures that he wanted them to study was Sri Ishapanishad and Bhagavad Gita. And then you take the examination and you get a degree called Bhakti Shastri. And then you take study Srimad Bhagavatam, and you get another degree called Bhakti Vaibhava. And then you study Vedanta Sutra and you get the highest degree and nectar of devotion. And you get the highest degree called Bhakti Vedanta. And Chaitanya Charitamrita is in there someplace too. So he wanted all these Vedic literatures to be available for his students and for them to study them. And he said when someone passes the Bhakti Vedanta examination, then they would be authorized to initiate. And this is the only place you will find in Srila Prabhupada's instructions that he gives the actual qualification of a spiritual master. The qualification of a spiritual master is that he must know the Vedanta Sutra. He must be able to discuss and preach on Vedanta Sutra very accurately, with full knowledge of the whole philosophy. So, in other words, to pass on our lineage to the next generation, this study and knowledge of Vedanta Sutra is absolutely necessary. And I spent 4 months over the summer working with different translations, because we don't have, in our lineage, we don't have a complete translation of Vedanta Sutra. We have some partial efforts, but there's no one complete. So I had to take some pieces from different editions and put them all together and harmonize everything. And I also had to give extended quotations from the Upanishads, because we don't have good translations of the Upanishads either. And Vedanta Sutra is all based on Upanishads. And if you don't know Upanishads, you wonder, what the heck are they talking about? So I had to include long quotations from the Upanishads to give the context of the discussion that appears in the Vedanta Sutra. And also the commentary by Baladev Vidyabhusan required some expansion and editing so that it was clear what he was talking about and also why it's relevant to our situation today. Otherwise you might wonder, well, he's talking about this Sankhya Yoga that some guy at Kapila made, you know, millions of years ago on another planet. Well, what does that have to do with us? Because the same philosophy is used by the material scientists. They say that matter can create itself, basically. That the world is created by matter. That matter is the source of the universe. Matter can organize itself and move itself around and establish everything just by material laws. But Vedanta says, no, this is not possible. It's not possible, because if we have some material object, like this thing, I put it on my knee here, well, do something. It's not going to do anything. It's just going to sit there until I pick it up. And then I can do something with it. But by itself, matter has no power. It has no energy. You put a rock on the ground, it'll just sit there forever. unless something comes along and moves it. Usually an intelligent being, a living being, will come along and say, oh, I need that rock over here, pick it up and move it. Or maybe a storm will come, or an earthquake or something like that. But without that, it just sits there. So where does the energy to move matter, and where does the intelligence to organize matter into especially the bodies of the living entities? Well, where does that come from? It can't come from matter. It has to come from something else. The only thing besides matter is spirit. So, in other words, without the existence of God, the spiritual world, and the living entities, the existence of the universe as we perceive it is impossible.